All right, guy. Oh, interesting. My pitch is higher. Yeah, I like to spit on things. Okay, can you guys let me know how things sound now? Have I fixed anything by chance? That fixed it? Oh, awesome. Cool. I really didn't expect that to fix it at all. That usually does not work. but the classic shut it off and turn it back on. I guess occasionally you got to do that. So now I know just to do that in the future if we ever have this issue. So anyways, welcome to SCUM Spooky Story Night. So I've been asking people for a lot of ideas as far as to expand SCUM Movie Night beyond just me sitting in a room. And so there's been a bit of an experimentation going on, and that's what tonight is too. It's a SCUM experiment, if you will, where we're going to be listening to some radio dramas I found of H.P. Lovecraft from the 1940s and 60s. I'm really excited. They have this incredible vintage analog crackle to them. And yeah. It's there's the deep timber. We can't be we'll put the whole computer in rice. We can't be having me having not a deep voice. That defeats the entire purpose of this, right? So anyways, we're going to be starting with the Dunwich Horror, which was, let's see, recorded by someone called Suspense and it was originally aired on the radio November 1st, 1945. Before we get started, I need to remember to ask you guys to actually like this video and subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. And also, if you can share this video with friends on your social media, that's the biggest thing as far as getting more people to the channel. We're almost at 700 subscribers, something like that. And when I hit the 1,000 subscriber mark, I'll be able to monetize this channel. And that'll be huge as far as making SCUM Movie Night a thing that I can like genuinely take seriously as a job, at least for like one night out of the week. And what else is there to talk about? We're going to have Ryan Shelf on the first Wednesday of January for The Last Man on Earth, I believe is what it was called, with Vincent Price. So it's going to be awesome to have Ryan here. If anybody else is interested in coming on to the set here and actually being a part of SCUM Movie Night, let me know. I want to bring as many people on who want to come on as possible. It's a lot of fun, and it was great to have Gaetano last time. Thank you so much, Gaetano, for the chair you bought. It sounds silly, but it was like really hard to find the right chair to have. You know, the other stuff, buying microphones and cables and stuff, I'm kind of good with that, but the chair is a little bit of a thing. Is the chat working, guys? I am not... The last thing I've seen is Nikki saying, next time put it in rice. Does that look, is that correct? Can someone let me know? Okay, it's working. All right, neat, perfect. I just want to make sure. What else? Neat, wunderbar. How's it going, Eric? everybody's just enthralled. What else? Oh, so on the topic of Lovecraft, a couple of people have pointed this out to me. As a general statement on this channel, we're watching and listening to content that was created as far back as the 19-teens and the through the 40s, 50s, 60s, occasionally a movie from the 70s, but especially the stuff from the 40s and back. The norms of the time with what was considered racist or sexist is just abhorrent, right? Like, it's, the racism is terrible, the misogyny is ridiculous, and I think everybody who's a friend of mine or who's been on the channel for a bit knows that if we laugh at something, it's one of those laugh so you don't cry type things, but you know, anybody who's new to the channel, I just don't want anybody to get freaked out about the fact that there's casual racism. We're not okay with it. But it is what it is. I mean, it's part of history, what was going on. It's like a movie like The Monster Walks still blows me away, where it's like a really good movie right up to the end where they drop an incredibly racist joke like it's nothing. And today it's like that, it's horrifying, but back then that was just normal. And so there's nothing normal about racism. There's nothing normal about sexism, transphobia, what have you. It's wrong. We all think it's wrong. But it's part of watching old movies, and so we just try to get through it and have a fun night with friends. So that's kind of what this whole channel's about. And H.P. Lovecraft is an interesting guy because he had some racism in his stories, and seemed more outside of his stories to be a genuinely bad racist at a time where racism wasn't even that bad. Like, he seems worse than usual on the topic of racism, which is a shame because he's the greatest horror writer of all time, in my opinion. I think he's much better than Edgar Allan Poe, although he did venerate Poe. Stephen King is up there too, of course. And so, anyways, just on that topic, like, I don't feel that I should have to every video go over this, but today I'm going over it. We all hate racism here, right? And if you're racist, get the fuck out of my channel. I don't give a fuck, okay? And we're gonna enjoy some Lovecraft stuff, and, you know, that's it. I'm gonna get off my soapbox. That's enough. That's enough of that shit. I just wanted to put it out there how I feel, if it wasn't skull-fuckingly obvious what I'm about. Now y'all know. And so, yeah, we're gonna get in on this. And as a... you know, when we... Hey, what's up, Chris? How are you doing, brother? And one more note on the topic of doing a radio drama. We've never done this before. It's a scum experiment. So we're going to see how this goes. But because it's an audio format thing, I'm not sure how much I'm going to be speaking on the mic. I'm definitely going to be in the chat if I feel I can't speak on the mic. But I actually don't know how it'll go. And I don't want to talk over things and stuff like that. So we're going to just see. I think I'll still be able to talk, but if not, if I go silent, I'll just be in the chat. And obviously that's on the stream over there. So you guys can, I'll still be here. We'll still be having fun. So anyways, I think that's enough of a thing. Oh my god, yeah, Chris and Bucky, I don't know how long it's been since you guys have caught up, but anyways, I'm really excited to have this going on. And yeah, let's get started. I'm glad that the audio problems are all fixed. And we are going to be taking a nice little journey to here tonight, into hell. It begins. Let me know how the volume is, okay, guys?
Mr. Ronald Coleman, a star of the Dunwich Horror, a suspense play produced, edited, and directed by William Spear.
This is so awesome.
Come in, Dunwich, Massachusetts. Come in, Dunwich.
Good evening. This is Henry Armitage. I'm speaking to you for... Dr. Rice, please close the window. I'm speaking to you from my laboratory on the slopes of Sentinel Hill near Dunwich, Massachusetts. Present with me is Dr. Warren Rice, my distinguished colleague from Miskatonic University. We are now about 100 yards from the summit of the hill, which is crowned by a huge table-like stone set in the center of a circle of stone pillars, a place of prehistoric worship. A moment ago, you may have heard the dogs of Dunwich Township barking, as we have heard them for 3 days and three nights. Dr. Rice and I know the horror which their barking portends, but the purpose of this broadcast is to make this unbelievable horror believable to you.
This must have been so cool in 1945.
We are successful tonight. It is the eve of All Hallows. Tomorrow will be too late.
the spooky music. Crescendos.
Our time tonight is very short, so I'll speak only of those more recent events, which, believe me, may culminate at any moment in a climax too frightful to wholly contemplate. I will begin with the birth of Wilbur Whateley. It was the night of February the 2nd, 1921. Candlemas. toward dawn when Lavinia Whateley, a deformed albino woman about 35 years old, gave birth to her dark, goatish-looking son in the crumbling Whateley farmhouse northeast of the village.
Well, it seems like we've already got upon some racist themes pretty quickly here.
Attended her. No doctor or midwife. No one was with her.
Except little her albino sergeant.
Father, who was known as Wizard Whateley. So Wilbur came into this world under heaven knows what incantations, what appeals to what power. A week later, Wizard Whateley drove his sleigh into Dunwich Village and reported the event to a group of loungers in Osborne's general store.
Hey, your grandson got yellow hair like Lavinia Wizard?
No, pigs after his father more. He's dark, dark.
You never spoke of who his father might be now, did you?
Oh, you know his father when the time comes. Oh, Lavinia's read and seen some things the most of you only talk about.
Lucky I just had a fucking heart attack.
As good as you can find this side of Aylesbury.
We don't be nosy, would you?
Maybe it warn't no church that none of you heard of. But you wouldn't ask no better church wedding than Lavinia's.
Well, I didn't hear tell no wedding, wizard. When was that?
Oh, not a wedding you'd hear of, Corey. Not a husband you'd hear of, neither. But let me tell you something. Someday you folks will hear a child of Lavinia's calling its father's name. On top of Sentinel Hill.
I love this music so much. I just added a 4 kilohertz boost to the audio.
Or idle boasting by an insane old man?
If that helps at all.
I know I ask a great deal when I ask you to believe that the arrival of an infant into that house of dire poverty and squalor could possibly constitute a horror and a threat to all our known world. Yet it has an earthly history. Perhaps through this history, you will be able to give it credence. Wilbur Whateley's growth was uncanny. But even if he had been an average child, he would have become, in time, an unnatural being, for he was surrounded from the first by the most malign influences. There was his grandfather, old Whateley, Wizard Whateley, who each Halloween climbed Sentinel Hill to the Great Circle of Stone, and while the hills shook, stood holding a great book open on his arms and shrieked into the wind. Shrieked.
Whoa, got really fucking shrieky there for a second.
Yog-Sothoth. That dreadful name.
I was saying Yog-Sothoth.
Mentioned in the hideous forbidden book, the Necronomicon.
I was curious what old one we were starting with.
Was Wilbur's teacher.
I like Yog-Sothoth.
The villagers began to notice curious things that were going on at the Whateley farmhouse. Soon after Wilbur was born, old Whateley began to remodel the house. The abandoned upper story was restored, and all the windows were tightly boarded up. And then, Wizard began to buy cattle in large numbers, both horses and cows.
Nothing weird about that.
The livestock on the farm didn't seem to increase. Young Lem Brown was one.
Goats
day,
are fucked up, though. I don't like goats.
Close to the house to count the Whateley herd.
Dr. Armitage, there weren't more than 12 cows, and them sick. Looked like they had the blight and funny wounds on them, like cuts. I heard something, too, in the top part of Wizard's house. Something like water slapping inside, only big, big like a sea.
You guys better have the lights turned down low for this, too, by the way. This is definitely a, like a shut the
One
lights down and chill.
Went to the Whateley farm in the years before I met Wilbur.
Dr. Agreed,
Ken
Chris.
Houghton of Aylesbury, who was called by Wilbur himself, who said that his grandfather was dying.
Fuck you,
Dr.
spoiled
Houghton
it.
Houghton found the old man in a bedroom on the ground floor, and Wilbur with him. While outside the window, a legion of whippoorwills cried loudly and rhythmically, endlessly.
A whippoorwill?
Wilbur spoke about the sound.
Listen, they whistle in time with his breathing now. They're ready. Listen, Doctor. The They know his soul's going out. They're waiting.
Yes, Wilbur, that's an interesting superstition. Late in the year for them, too.
And when he goes, if they catch him, they'll keep laughing till break of day. If they don't catch him, they'll quiet down.
You mean you believe that... In just a minute. I think he's conscious.
Yes, the birds changed when his breathing changed. Like
Willie,
I say.
Willie!
I'm here.
More space, Willie. Remember, more space.
I love little birds.
Yes, I'll build it.
You grows, but that grows faster. It'll be ready to serve you soon, Willie.
I know.
But remember, when it's time, you open up the gates to Yog-Sothoth with a long chant. The one on page 751 of the book. But mind you, feed it enough. Because if it gets out before you opens to Yog-Sothoth, it's all over. It's no use.
Smoke weed every day.
Ducky, thank you very much for the $4.20 tip. It's really appropriate right now that that one pops up on screen over there.
The birds, they didn't get him.
He definitely said burbs. The burbs didn't get him. Hey, Justin, how are you? No eyebrow checks tonight, unfortunately, as we are just watching this endless ocean.
The winter following Wizard Waitley's death that I first met Wilbur, he came in person to the library at Miskatonic University.
Can we fill Justin in with what's happened so far?
Necronomicon, which was kept there in its Latin version, as printed in Spain in the 17th century.
By the I tell you, mad Arab
when he came
Abdul,
into my office,
whatever
I was
his name is.
At his appearance. 8 feet tall, shabby, dirty, bearded. But I was even more appalled by his voice when he spoke to me.
I wrote you a letter a month past, Doctor. I wanted a loan of the book.
Well, that's a book that's never loaned from this library. I doubt if it is from any library.
Well, I have to see it, then.
Oh, very well. It's kept right here. As you know, there are only 3 copies of this book in existence. That's why we're careful. Here, you can look at it on this table.
Wizard said it would be on page 751.
What?
Never read page 751.
Formula, the long chant, the one that opens the gate to Yog-Sothoth.
Sothoth. The music's actually really good. Hey, Kelly, how's it going?
It seemed somehow like the spawn of another dimension, like something only partly of mankind, linked to black gulfs beyond all spheres of force and matter, space and time. And presently he raised his head and spoke again.
It's here, all right, but I'll have to have a copy.
Well, that paragraph there? I don't know.
Do you know Latin, Doctor?
Yes, certainly.
Then read it, Doctor. Let's hear how you make it out.
All right, that shouldn't be difficult. Let's see. Nor is it to be thought that man is the oldest or the last of Earth's masters. The old ones were, and the old ones shall be. Not in the spaces that we know, but
spit it
between
out
between them. But only Yog-Sothoth knows the gate. Yog-Sothoth is the gate to where the old ones broke through of old. Their hands are at your throat. Yet ye see them.
James
not.
Mason?
Dr. Armitage, you see, I reckon I've got to take that book home.
His voice is actually
I've got to try and you
creepy.
Can't hold me up.
No, I'm sorry.
I tell you, Doctor, I'll have the book sooner or later, no matter what. You see, it that's waiting for me at home won't wait much longer.
Dun, dun, dun. Yeah, but it's the Twilight Zone vibes are so good.
A week later that I was awakened suddenly by the fierce yelping of the great watchdog on the campus.
Hey, Gaetano, how's it going, my brother?
From a wholly different throat, a scream. And I knew instantly that Wilbur had come back for the Necronomicon. I hastened into my clothes and rushed across to the library where a crowd had gathered before the smashed window of my office. Inside, there was a fearful groaning and growling, and some instinct warned me that what was taking place there was not for unfortified eyes to see.
Thank you, Gaetano.
Motioning only to Professor Rice to come in with me. When we opened the study door, Professor Rice screamed.
No, Dr. Armitage, no, I can't.
Come, close the door. We can't let them see. He's alive, but Lord, what a job that dog's done. Torn him to bits. Oh, that's a horrible sound, that moaning. You suppose we ought to call a doctor?
A doctor? A doctor for that? No doctor in the world would know what to do for that. Look, Armitage, it's not human, nor animal. Where did it come from? Can you tell me? Can you tell me what it is?
I love the music in this. It's just so classic.
Thing that lay half bent on its side in a pool of greenish yellow stickiness was 9 feet tall.
Greenish yellow stickiness.
And the dog had torn off all the clothing and some of the skin. It was partly human, beyond a doubt, with very man-like hands and head, but the torso and lower parts of the body were fabulous. Chest had the leathery hide.
Did he say fabulous?
Crocodile or alligator. But below the waistline, the skin was covered with coarse black fur.
Below
and
the waistline.
The abdomen, long greenish gray tentacles.
I need a shot.
Of the limbs terminated
tentacles.
In ridges veined pads that were neither hooves nor claws. And as Dr. Rice and I stood tearing at this presence, the whippoorwills
so
began to cry in unison outside the study window.
The whippoorwills, the little birds.
Aroused and mumbled. The whippoorwills.
Tentacles is one of those ones where it's like funny to me because I always feel like it's not actually in that many of Lovecraft's works, but whenever it does show up, it's amazing.
Fast, too. Fading away. Because he isn't made of matter as we know it on Earth. I guess he took after his father, so there'll be nothing left.
His father? What was his father?
I daren't think.
Anytime you see stars. It's actually quite well orchestrated for something. I mean, this must have been quite a production for the time.
I thought then that what came into our world with Wilbur Whately left with him.
That
I
is
what
one
he
seriously perverted bitch.
Which was waiting in the sealed house Wizard Whately had built, where the cattle were driven to disappear.
Anonymous, thank you so much for the $10 donation. I really appreciate it.
Written in a strange alphabet resembling Sanskrit. And I worked off and on for weeks to decipher it. And finally, I read the following passage written by Wilbur when he was no more than 8 years old.
That upstairs is more ahead of me than I had thought it would be. And is not like to have much earth brain. I can see it a little when I make the sign or blow the powder of Ivangatze at it. And it is like them I see Halloween on the hill. I wonder how I shall look when the earth is cleared and there are no earth beings. Maybe like that upstairs looks, which has no body, even fed with all the blood.
It's actually creepy.
One morning, in a cold sweat of terror, I called Dr. Rice to my house and told him we had
that
to destroy
is one
what's in that farmhouse.
Bitch.
Why can't we just leave the thing locked up there?
The void. Thank you for the $5 tip. I appreciate it.
Don't you realize, man, it hasn't been fed? It hasn't had blood since the 18th of September, when Wilbur Whately came here to die. We left for Dunwich that night. And we've been here on Sentinel Hill ever since, working desperately to discover the formula in time. But a week ago tonight, shortly after dawn... Yeah, hello?
Dr. Armitage, this is Lem Brown. I was just up beyond the glen, Doctor, looking for cows I lost last night.
Yes, Lem?
Well, Doctor, something's been there.
That's a good fake radio sound, or telephone sound.
Great round prints, big as barrel heads, like an elephant has been along.
Anything else, Lem?
That's all I see, except bushes and trees pushed back from the road, like a house was drug along.
Did you hear anything?
Yes. Long toward morning, I heard a sound over toward Whately's place. A kind of ripping or tearing of wood, like a big box was being opened up. Chancy, he heard it too.
Lem, who lives nearest the Whately farm?
Why, that'd be Elmer Fry's place.
Well, he's on this line too, isn't he? Hang on and I'll ring him.
It's adorable. It's a small world back then, you know. Like, just hold on.
Yes, Dr. Armitage, this is Central.
I'm trying to get Elmer Fry, Central.
Doctor, he must be out somewheres, and his whole family. I was ringing there an hour ago. Earl Sawyer saw Elmer's cows stampeding in Cold Spring Glen.
Oh, you didn't get him. All right. But if you hear or see anything more, let me know. I'll be here working all day. Rice! Rice! Wake up. It's loose. It's out of the house. One family gone already. We have to work. Pray God we find that formula in time.
Okay, so I guess the Dunwich Horror is loose, and they have to find the formula in time. So that's kind of like our plot point, I guess, like, or the descriptor of where the rest of this is going.
Broke loose. A week of terror and panic here in Dunwich Township. Each night it moves about the countryside, leaving the trees crushed in a 30-foot swathe. As though by a moving mountain, leaving its monstrous tracks and a trail of tarry stickiness, leaving crushed and gutted farmhouses.
That stickiness is so fucking gross.
Drained of blood. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that is the story to this moment. And tonight is Halloween. Tonight we are here to... Just one moment, please. Dr. Rice...
Oh my god, I love this. It's like,
who's
telling the story, but now we're actually like in the story. It's happening live. You know, like, oh my god, it's so adorable.
A sound from a thousand bending trees. A sound like the sea moving across a forest. Yes.
The sound like a thousand bending trees is awesome. Description.
It comes to Sentinel Hill. Dr. Rice, I'll try the formula and the powder from the altar stone. I want you to stay here at the microphone and report what you see.
Very well, Dr. Armitage.
Oh, wait a minute before I go. To any scientists who may be listening to me, if I fail, there is a possible alternative formula in Falconer's Mystical Formulae of the Middle Ages on page 24. Listen. Well, there are the whippoorwills. I better get out there. Take over, Dr. Rice.
Not the fucking whippoorwills.
I'll do as well as I can.
Not the little burbs.
Good luck.
Everybody knows birds. That's the truest terror.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Armitage is climbing to the top of the hill, to the altar stone. I can see him plainly, for the moon is high and the night clear. Down the hill, toward the dark village, I can see the grasses and shrubbery bending down, marking the monster's ascent.
I'll never be able to hear the word Trevor without thinking of Monty Python and the Holy Grail.
Phases of being are to be forbidden. Now, Dr. Armitage stands now on the altar stone and is holding the powder which, if the books are correct, will make this thing for an instant visible. It is quite close to him now, perhaps 20 yards or less. He lifts his hands. He flings the powder in a wide arc. I can see... Oh, no! No!
Dr. Rice, come in, Dunwich. Ladies and gentlemen, this is your suspense announcer. Due to condition... Oh, just a moment, please.
I love the way they're doing this. Like, this sort of, like, we can't tell what's...
One moment, please. Dr. Rice, can you hear me?
Like, it's happening in real time.
I can hear you. Yes, for a moment I was overcome when I saw... Ladies and gentlemen, perhaps you can hear now the incantation of Dr. Armitage. Listen.
I wonder how they made that sound back then. The true terror. Burbs.
The whippoorwills mean death. And Dr. Armitage is walking back here now. So we know that whatever it was, it is gone. It is dead. We can be thankful indeed. You see, I saw a Dr. Armitage.
Yes. Did you see it, Dr. Rice?
I saw it, Lord, yes.
What did it look like to you?
It looked
here
like something made of squirming ropes, but bigger than a barn and shaped, well, like an egg. And dozens of legs, like barrels that half closed when it stepped, and nothing solid about it, and at least 15 or 20 mouths or trunks opening and closing, but what was it?
Oh, a kind of force that doesn't belong in our part of space.
That's the shit.
Did you notice the half face on top?
Half face, like a human face.
Yes, very large, but yes, quite human, and quite like Wilbur's, like all the weightless.
Then it was.
That's right. It was Wilbur's twin brother, and you saw what 3 weeks' growth had done. And it was the child of Lavinia's who called its father's name on Sentinel Hill, as Wizard Waitley prophesied. You heard it calling, Yog-Sotho. Ladies and gentlemen, this night is over. It is All Saints' Day. May heaven bless us all.
Wow. So I guess the moral of the story is...
The Dunwich Horror, with Ronald Coleman as your star of suspense.
That sounds sucked. All right, so we're moving on to The Black Mass, Rats in the Walls, which was originally aired July 3rd, 1964.
This is the Armed Forces Radio Service.
All right, yeah, here we go.
This is WJZ, New York's first station, and WJZ
FM. Yes, moral,
FM.
Don't trust burbs. Burbs are the worst.
The inside version of the news, the factual highlights that lie behind the headlines. Listen for Drew Pearson coming up next. Stronger, shock-resisting. Yes.
All right, here we go. Oh, this isn't stereo. That's nice. Hey, Amanda, how are you doing? Yeah, it was like a egg the size of a barn made of tentacles with many mouths and many legs with the face of an albino.
Welcome to the Black Mass.
Oh, what a fucking cool sound. I feel like I'm in Club Silencio from Mulholland Drive. If you guys have seen that movie, it's my favorite movie of all time. I think it's my all-time fave. What else would be up there?
One of the foremost writers of pure horror and the supernatural is H.P. Lovecraft.
Daddy Lovecraft.
He regarded all his work as based on the idea that the world was inhabited at one time by another race, which in practicing black magic, lost its foothold and was expelled, yet lives on, outside, ever ready to take possession of this earth again. Tonight,
is that actually
one
accurate?
Of his most famous tales, The Rats in the Walls, by H.P. Lovecraft.
Is it sad that I'm actually a little bit sad that this sounds so good? Like, I really like the sound of the 1940s, like, where it was all degraded and gritty and, you know, sounded like it was coming off a vinyl record or old tape. Like, the audio quality is gorgeous here.
The restoration of Exham Priory had been a stupendous task, for little had remained of the deserted pile but a shell-like ruin. But because it had been the seat of my ancestors, I let no expense deter me. The place had not been inhabited since the reign of James the First, when a tragedy of intensely hideous, though largely unexplained, nature occurred. It appeared that my ancestor was accused, with much reason, of having killed all the other members of his household in their sleep.
Killed with
this deliberate slaughter,
with much
which
reason,
included his father, as well as three brothers and two sisters, was strangely condoned by the villagers and slackly treated by the law. With this sole heir, nevertheless legally denounced as a murderer, the estate had reverted to the crown, the accused man making no attempt to exculpate himself or regain his property.
The music here
shaken
is
by some
gorgeous
horror greater than that of conscience or the law, and expressing only a frantic wish to exclude the ancient edifice from his sight and memory, Walter de la Power fled to the United States.
Not the move,
where,
bro.
By the end of several generations, the family had achieved a proud and honorable, if somewhat reserved and unsocial, Virginia line. After the Civil War, the family moved north. I emerged and grew to manhood.
I emerged.
To middle age and to ultimate wealth within the greyness of a Massachusetts business life.
I can't wait till I hit middle
My
age and they give me the ultimate wealth.
Died shortly after the birth of our only son, Alfred. And Alfred, in the Aviation Corps in 1917. They both had died, leaving me old, bereaved, and aimless, a retired manufacturer.
So sad. Hey, Annie, how are you?
I traveled, eventually.
Good timing, it just started.
Eventually to Anchester.
Really, all that happened was a British man
eventually
came to America and his family died.
The ancient family seat, Exham Priory itself.
B-Ops, welcome to the stream.
A jumble of tottering medieval ruins, covered with lichens. Perched perilously upon a precipice, denuded of floors and other interior features save the stone walls and the separate towers. The priory had been allotted to the estate of the Norris family by the crown. And now, three centuries later, I purchased the rune for a surprisingly reasonable figure.
Especially when you have ultimate wealth.
Resolved to divert my remaining years by restoring my ancestral home.
This is like, the audio on this is insane. It's really, really good.
The interest, assistance, and the friendship of Captain Norris.
Big mood, Justine.
His knowledge of the place had been increased through the years by his having accompanied the many architects and antiquarians who loved to examine the strange relic. He knew every detail of its history and its former structure, and became of inestimable help in the reconstruction.
The priory itself actually stands on the site of a prehistoric temple. Yes. A druidical or anti-druidical thing, which must have been contemporary of Stonehenge and dates like that.
Well, it's unfortunate that our neighbors are at all antiquarians such as you, Captain Norris. I had not been in Anchester a day before I knew I came from an accursed house.
Oh, yes, the
I hear some birds in the background. That means death is imminent.
I'm afraid. They hated the priory hundreds of years ago when your ancestors lived here. And they hate it now, with the moss and mold of abandonment on it.
Yes, I don't seem to be able to convince the villagers how little I know of my heritage.
Oh, but to them a lineage is beyond a message. Rational or not, you know, they view Exham Priory as nothing less than a haunt of fiends and werewolves.
Captain Norris, superstitions, ghosts and
goblins. Oh, no, not quite that.
They're giggling about worries, superstitions and it's about, well, to go down.
It's not a matter of the present. And it's not all superstition. This is an ancient place, Power.
That next time I see a bird, I'm going to go
rites
running.
Have been celebrated here, no one doubts. Rites of the Sibylle worship, which the Romans had introduced. Inscriptions still visible in the subcellar of the priory bear the unmistakable letters and signs of Magna Mater, whose dark worship was once vainly forbidden to Roman citizens. You know, the people didn't need any walls to keep them out. They were too frightened of the place altogether.
I was just going to say, there's definitely a video of me being frightened by a bird.
The fireside tales were of the most grisly description. All the... Mind your head, darling.
And there was definitely that one parrot at Gatorland that was losing his shit.
Cloudy evasiveness. Like I'm afraid they represented your ancestors as a race of hereditary demons.
But what precisely happened, Norris? What went on?
Well, there are the vaguer tales. Hackneyed spectral lore, perhaps. Wails and the usual howlings heard around the place. Graveyard stench after the spring rains. The servant girl who'd gone
graveyard
mad.
Graveyard stench? Is that what I think it is?
Day in the priory. The accounts of vanished peasants are less to be dismissed, though not especially significant in view of medieval custom. Prying curiosity meant death. And more than one severed head had been publicly shown on the bastions around Exham Priory.
I'm going to try to find this video.
Well, it's difficult. A few of the tales were exceedingly picturesque. For instance, the belief that a legend of bat-winged devils kept witches...
Hey, Chris, thank you for subscribing to the channel. I appreciate it.
Sustenance must explain the disproportionate abundance of coarse vegetables harvested in the gardens. But most vivid of all, there was the dramatic epic of the rats.
The rats?
Yes, the scampering army of obscene vermin which had burst forth from the castle a couple of months after the tragedy that doomed the place to desertion.
That is one seriously perverted bitch.
The void. Thank you for tipping $11. I appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Before it and devoured fowl, cats, dogs, hogs, sheep, and, you know, even two villagers before its fury was spent. Yes, around that unforgettable rodent army, a cycle of myths revolves. It scattered among the village homes and brought curses and horrors in its train.
Yes, and that was just 3 months after Walter de la Power had murdered his family and fled to Virginia.
Yes, I should say about that.
You know, one thing puzzles me about that murder. Walter de la Power must have known for years the sinister tales about his family, so that this material could have given him no fresh impulse. I can scarcely conjecture what discovery could have prompted an act so terrible. What had he witnessed or stumbled upon?
The general
whispered sentiment seems to have been
one seriously perverted bitch.
The band of immemorial curse.
Justine, thank you so much for the tip. Birds
such
be bitches.
Such was the law that assailed me as I began.
Thank you. I'm trying to find this video of me being scared by the birds.
The work of restoring my ancestral home. While living with Captain Norrie's family during the restoration of the Priory, I collected many such tales of superstition or fact. But it must not be imagined that they formed my principal psychological environment. I was constantly praised and encouraged by Captain Norrie's and the antiquarians who surrounded and aided me. When the task
was done, I love the phrase antiquarians.
Over 2 years after its commencement, I viewed the great rooms with pride. Wainscoted walls, vaulted ceilings, mullioned windows, broad staircases. All there, all as it had been, every attribute of the Middle Ages was cunningly reproduced. The new parts blended perfectly with the original stone walls and foundations. The seat of my fathers was complete. And I looked forward to redeeming at last the local fame of the line. Which ended with me.
The local fame of the line. So I'm trying to get this
the
file,
interior
but it's not letting me download it.
Was in truth wholly new and free from old vermin and old ghosts. The first incident occurred 6 days after I moved into the Priory.
The first incident.
That night, dispensing as usual with a valet, I retired to the West
like paranormal
Tower
activity
chamber,
from,
I had chosen
back
as
in the
my
day.
Own. The room was circular, very high, and without wainscoting, the stones being hung with tapestries. I did not draw the curtains, but gazed out at the narrow north window, which I faced from the canopied four-poster. At some time, I must have fallen quietly asleep, for I recall a distinct sense of leaving strange dreams.
Put your arm up and look.
At a point on the wall, a point to which my eye had nothing to mark it, but toward which all my attention was directed. Whether the tapestry actually moved, I cannot say. I think it did very slightly. But what
Sneaky
I can swear to is
tapestry.
That behind it, I heard a low, distinct scurrying, as of mice or rats.
As of mice
then
or rats.
Gone. Some sort of effect of echo, perhaps,
scared
coming from
daddy.
Some other area of the house. There was no need of my looking
exactly.
behind
Put
the
your arm
house.
Up and look.
The walls were of solid stone, several feet thick. It was a while before I could drift back to sleep, and I seemed
Some
directly to re-enter
music.
My earlier dream, except that this time, the vision was clearly, horribly before me.
Correct, Annie.
I seemed to be looking down, down from an immense height upon a twilit grotto, knee-deep with filth, where a white-bearded demon, a swineherd, drove about with his staff a flock of fungus beasts.
fungus burbs.
Filled me with unutterable loathing.
Yes, exactly, Annie.
As the swineherd paused and nodded over his task, a mighty swarm of rats rained down on the stinking abyss and fell to devouring beasts and men alike. But suddenly I was awake, wide awake. On every side of the chamber, the walls were alive with nauseous sound. The verminous slithering of ravenous, gigantic rats. I could see a hideous shaking all over the tapestry.
Dude.
But the motion disappeared almost at once, and the sound with it. I sprang out of bed and tore aside the arras to see what lay beneath it. Nothing. Nothing but the patched stone wall. I stepped out of the room and stood for a moment at the head of the great ancient stairway, listening to the house. I could hear
had
them.
A couple too many hallucinogens.
I could hear them faintly at first, but coming from all the walls. And as I descended, the stampeding continued with such force and distinctness that I could finally assign to their motions a definite direction. These creatures, in numbers apparently inexhaustible, were engaged in one stupendous migration from inconceivable height to some depth inconceivably below.
Yeah, I would be fucking
rats?
Terrified.
When I questioned the servants, they said they heard nothing. I didn't want to alarm them by insisting. No,
fucking
I wasn't
servants.
Clean, Norris.
I was so afraid, Justine.
But there have been no rats at the Priory for 300 years. Even the field mice couldn't be found in these high walls.
Wherever would they be found in walls of solid stone?
You say they were headed downward.
Captain Norris helped me explore the subcellar, but absolutely nothing untoward was found. We could not, however, repress a thrill at the knowledge that this vault was built by Roman hands.
See up here, it's harmonious classicism of the age of the Caesars. Look here at these inscriptions. T.M. Temp Dona Lucius Praecius Pontificatus. Or is it Attis? Yes, Attis.
The reference made me shiver. But I had
looks like you've got ghosts in your blood. Here's a boy's kid in cocaine.
Of the Eastern God. Whose worship was so mixed with that of Sibylle.
Look, hold your lantern up here. No, not that yes. One. That, by this stone block here.
Oh, yes, I see.
Yes, you
this
see
one is much easier to talk over because there's, like, more
sun?
Space between.
That's not Roman. No, that's not and Roman it's more, at all. It's of an earlier origin. These altars have
intelligible
merely been adopted
the
by the Roman
for.
Priests from some older, perhaps aboriginal temple on the same site. Come down here.
Aboriginal?
Norris and I determined to pass the night in the crypt, and couches were brought down by the servants. We retired with
the
lantern still burning.
Are you fucking crazy?
To await whatever might occur.
The true heroes of the story are the servants who brought the couches down there so they could just chill like bros in the crypt.
That it had been the goal of the scuffling and unexplainable rats, I could not doubt. But why? Why? As we lay there expectantly, I found my vigil occasionally mixed with half-formed dreams. I saw the twilight grotto and the swineherd.
The twilight grotto.
The fungus beasts wallowing in filth. They seemed nearer.
Fungus
nearer
beasts.
And more distinct. I could almost observe their features. Beasts. But not exactly beasts. They became more distinct as I watched, looking up at me. Terrifying, terrifying. Norris, Norris, wake up, Norris. Wake up,
classic acting right there.
What's wrong?
Do you hear? Honestly, the first moment of this whole thing, it wasn't like super sold on.
I heard nothing.
The production quality on this is just insane.
They were going still farther down.
No.
There are cellars below us, Norris.
Cellars?
Norris, was it hallucination? Was it madness? Why have they stopped? Why have they stopped? Why is it silent now?
Perhaps you've been shown what certain forces wish to show you.
They were headed downward. In this altar. See, Norris? The lantern,
certain
the lantern
forces.
Flickers at the crevice here between the altar and the floor. There must be some kind of...
By Jove!
There must be some way of descending, some door, some kind of entrance.
Balanced by some sort of counterweight, I expect. You see, look here. Look.
Like how there's a slapback echo.
The stone pivots aside.
Like it sounds like they're in a cavern.
By Jove!
By Jove!
There's your cellar power.
A horror. Stone steps descended into an abysmal dark, but scrawled across them as far as we could see, skeletons, attitudes of panic, fear, all over them,
horror.
The marks of rodent gnawings, a ghastly array of human or semi-human bones, creeping.
Semi-human.
Semi-apedom.
Oh dear.
We descended the hellishly littered steps.
We're gonna just pass over that one. My rant at the beginning of the video should be enough.
Out through solid rock. Notice the strokes here. Look, according to the direction of wind, this passage must have been chiseled from beneath, upward. No? Look at that. You notice the air? There's a cool movement of air, probably some fissure in the cliffs above. Yes, look, Pa, the stairway ends here. There's light filtering down from somewhere up here. I can't quite see it, but... Hey, it must be morning outside. You know, almost enough light to see. It's a sort of grotto. Enormous.
Enormous.
The descent from reality had almost prepared me for what was to come. Norris, when I reached him, stared out with a look resembling that of the skulls at his feet. Then I followed his eyes over the subterranean world before us. Dear God.
We must not underestimate the archaeological importance of such a discovery as this, huh?
The twilight grotto was of enormous height and stretched farther than any eye could see. There were buildings and other architectural remains. In the center, a circle of monoliths, but dwarfed, everything dwarfed by the spectacle on the ground. An insane tangle of bones, human or nearly so. Like a foamy sea, they stretched pastures of demonic frenzy, either fighting off some menace or clutching other forms with cannibal intent.
I definitely think that this one captures the spirit of Lovecraft, like the insanity, the madness.
Every case definitely human. Actually, some of them seem to be supremely and sensitively developed types.
Horror.
That were sensitive.
Horror upon horror.
All the bones gnawed.
Altars serving as butcher shop and kitchen.
Mostly by rats.
Cauldrons. Dining tables.
Not
fucking rats.
Goblets brown stained and dried. Horror upon horror.
Notice the stone pens over here. For the keeping of herd, I expect, and out of which they must have broken in their last delirium of hunger or rat fear. Herds of some primordial human type. Yes, fascinating. And there a row of cells nearly rusted through. The tenants still locked inside.
And on the bony forefinger of one, a seal ring with my own coat of arms.
Oh my God, he's a descendant
strange
of the semi-humans.
Carvings here on some of the skulls. Hey,
the horror.
Look at this part. for I believe they're Phrygian in origin.
I love that sound. It reminds me of
this
Alien.
Is a
even though this would have been
bones with parallel inscriptions
15 years
Greek
before.
And Latin.
Still downward, I could hear them. Where else could they draw me? Across the grotto, carrion pits of sawed bones, picked bones, open skulls, nightmare chasms, unhallowed centuries grinning their unnameable fancies. Then to the edge of a depth hideously foreshadowed by my dreams.
An apparently boundless depth. Power, there's no end to it. A great mouth lined with human debris. Spewing, swallowing, yawning out from the primordial. Power, stay out of it! Stay out of it, man!
The rats, questing new horrors, determined to lead me on. I ran, following them,
This one's so good. Like, I'm just totally hooked right now.
I heard voices, echoes, but above all that insidious scurrying. I felt them all around me. I was one of them, part of the ravenous army that feasts on the living and the dead.
Dude's
well,
fucking
why
losing
should rats eat a de la power? As a de la power eat forbidden things? No, I am not that demon in the twilight grotto. It's not Nari's body I tear apart. It's not blood I feast upon and flesh. You faint and fear at what my family do. It's blood I'll stick and I'll learn you how to cross. World is wine, you little wife.
Oh my God.
This is what they said. I said, when they found me in the black, over the half-eaten body of Captain Nari.
Oh my God, he
now
ate his friend.
Now they have blown up Exum Priory and shut me into this barred room at Hardwell. With fearful whispers about my heredity and experience. When I speak of poor Nari's, they accuse me of a hideous thing. But they must know that I did not do it. I did not do it. They must know it was the rats. It was the rats.
Scampering
will never let me sleep. The demon rats. That race behind the padding of this room and beggared me down to greater heights than I have ever known. The rats, they can never hear. The rats in the wall. That was The Rats in the Walls.
It was also fucking awesome.
Lovecraft.
Holy shit.
The part of Captain Norris was played by Bernard Mays.
That was so
the part
good.
Of Power and the
dude, he ate his fucking friend.
By your host of The Black Mass, Eric Ballester.
It almost kind of had like a slightly anti-racist message, right? Because it was like, don't be obsessed with your heritage was sort of the moral of the story. Yeah, these are awesome. So by the way, guys, there's actually more of these types of things that we can do. But we'll just do one more tonight. But if this is the type of thing you'd like me to do on the channel more, we can make this a semi-regular thing. We could even do the War of the Worlds, and there's this other one called Quiet Please, which I think was sort of like a Twilight Zone, like an it's a radio show. It's not that popular, but man, they're really rocking out right now. But kind of the same idea as this, where it's these radio dramas, and they're apparently really good. So if that's the type of thing you'd like to see more of, you guys just let me know. Really, this is your channel, in a way, because it's what you guys want to see. That's what's kind of fun about this. You guys come up with ideas. Oh, they have Sherlock Holmes ones? I wonder if they're in the public domain. Because if they are, we are going to fucking hit that shit for sure. If you guys want. I like things like radio dramas. I don't know if for everybody, if they're as good. As the movies, obviously, are kind of more fun to just be able to, whatever. You don't have to look at the unending expanse here. You can watch stuff. Well, I'm glad these guys like him. If it's a... Maybe we'll do one of these next month, too, then, if that's something you guys want to do. There's not that many radio dramas that I'm aware of, so I feel like if we are going to do some more, probably get away with doing them every once a month or something like that. All right. Cool. It'll happen. I am working on a audio horror choose your own adventure for this channel too. Wow, this is like quite epic music. They're on? Oh, I see. Shows what I know, Chris. It's nice to have you on the channel, brother. Miss you, man. You're coming back to Florida, right? Yeah, something like that, Ryan, was what I was thinking.
Welcome to the Black Mass.
Yeah, so here's the next Black Mass. They're the ones who did the last one. This one was aired on November 20th, 1968. And this is The Outsider. Oh, I hope the audio quality is good, because this one doesn't sound like it's as clear as the last one. Yeah, Ryan's in charge of the schedule. It's a spooky sound. Sounds really scratchy.
In this program, you will hear The Outsider by H.P. Lovecraft.
It's interesting. It must be like there's no good quality version of this.
Here now is The Outsider by H.P. Lovecraft.
Old network radio mysteries. I will, Chris. Because I love this sort of shit. I love audio and just anything that's got this old vibe to it, So for me, this is phenomenal. Now, I bitched that the last one was so clean sounding, although it was so beautiful that I actually wish we had a clean version of this, because this one sounds kind of pretty grainy, pretty noisy, but that's okay. Should still be good.
Memories of childhood bring only fear and sadness. I know not where I was born. I remember only this castle. Infinitely old and infinitely horrible. Full of dark passages and dismal, high-ceilinged chambers. The stones in the crumbling corridors seemed always hideously damp. And the smell everywhere, coming up out of the deeper passages from the remains there.
This was my favorite story by Lovecraft.
That led endlessly down into the earth. The light was a dim and uniform gray, throwing no shadows. Outside in the forest, there was no sunlight able to come through the trees. The branches thickly interwove overhead, cutting out all sight of anything above. Except there was one black tower of the castle that reached beyond the trees. It rose up inside into a dark and inaccessible height. There was no stairway. It could not be ascended save by an impossible climb up the sheer wall, stone by stone. I must have lived in this place all my childhood, but I cannot measure the time. Someone must have cared for my needs, yet I cannot recall any person except myself.
Yeah, Chris has more of an old one feel.
Or anything else alive.
No, they are not.
Whoever nursed me.
This one sounds closer to a one to one, though.
Terribly aged. My first conception of a living person was of something distorted, shriveled, decaying. I remember there was such a corpse. I often went to it with a feeling of reverence and attachment. It was a woman, an ancient, lying as she had died. Partly eaten around the throat and chest, the terrible gesture of horror in her sprawled position and opened mouth. I would sometimes roam the passage where she lay. I seemed to be drawn there. I wanted to kneel before it, to lie my head against it.
I forgot, but what's worth saying here?
Once, I recall, I reached out to touch her, and she seemed to draw away in horror as if some instinct of recoil had penetrated to the very bones of the hideous thing.
That got me.
It fell off the ledge.
So when I wrote my first text, Adventure Dysnomia, I forgot, but it was kind of inspired by the story because the guy's just wandering these hallways, and that's sort of what the first game's like.
Otherwise, to me, there was nothing grotesque in the bones and skeletons that populated my world. They were to me more natural than the colored pictures of living people I found in many of the ancient books that lined shelves and piled corners. From such books, I learned all that I know. No teacher urged or guided me. And I do not recall hearing any human voice in all those years. Not even my own. Although I read of speech, I had never thought to try speaking aloud myself. I felt conscious of youth because I remembered so little. I'd wander outside by the moat, filled with a thick and stagnant water. Imagined it to be the great seas I saw in the picture books. I even constructed a boat, a toy boat, with masts, and set it upon the water. But the slime held it. It couldn't sail. I watched it slip through the surface, sinking slowly, inch by inch down.
The guy who did the voice actor here is just great.
Across the moat, under the dark, mute trees, I would often lie and dream for hours about what I read in the books, and would longingly picture myself there in the sunny world beyond the forest.
I love how the music kind of comes in the background while he's imagining.
There's now nothing to separate us.
Oh, there's a lady.
Nothing.
In his dreams.
The pictures would fade. They were not real. Oh, I wanted to make them real. I'd try to escape the forest. I'd run. I'd run, but the farther I ran from the castle, the more dense became the shade. The thickness filled me with a terrible fear until I forgot my search and turned back. Back. So through endless twilights I dreamed and waited. For what? Only skulls looked up at me, their gaping jaws, their silence. In my madness, I'd crush them. Who put me here? Why? My longing for light grew so frantic I could rest no more. The tower that reached up into the dark absorbed me. I stood beneath it and raised my hands into the abyss. There must be a way. There must be. I stood flat against the stones, grasping them. Strange, I could hold on to the stones more easily than I thought. I pulled myself up, stone by stone. Round the tower and up.
This one is like very hypnotic. I don't mean to not be talking as much, but maybe because it's a little bit harder to make out too.
And looked above. There was no end to the darkness.
But it's also just the nature of it is more like we're just kind of listening to this guy.
The light seemed to be fading. But I had no fear. Oh, no fear. No fear, only great anticipation.
That is one seriously perverted pitch.
Anonymous, thank you so much for the $6.66 cent tip. I appreciate it. Is anybody else thinking anticipation?
Places to hold. Hours later, I had reached the top. I clung to the stone, my head against a roof, a stone panel that would lift. Oh, the climb had strengthened, not weakened me. Oh, it took mere effort now to brace my shoulders against it and push up and out from the wall. The effort, the strain was pure joy.
Yeah, Biops, this narrator's going for it.
Something else was working, some other thing in me that drew me out. I was out. Stone had fallen shut, but I had reached the outside.
The goose is loose.
Was the radiant full moon. I had never seen it before except in dreams and in vague visions. Memory. Light fell upon me like But where was I? How high above the trees? It seemed I was on a stone platform. But vast, vast. An observatory. But there were columns about. Broken. And beyond the platform, other stones. Small ones with inscriptions and dates. And between the stones... Ah! Earth! Earth! There stretched around me nothing less than the solid earth, housed with marble slabs and columns, and overshadowed by an ancient stone church whose ruined spires gleamed spectrally in the moonlight.
Spectrally. Good word choice there.
The earth. Was this insanity? Or dreaming? Dreaming.
Spoiler alert, yes. It was insanity.
Oh, no, this was the world, and I would go forth to meet it. There were meadows with the smell of grass and trees that did not cover the sky. Oh, and houses. Some ancient ruins that my mind tried to reconstruct, but others with light. I could see figures inside.
This one's lights. Really creepy.
My mind played tricks. If I looked too long, the lights would fade. The figures melt away. The walls seem ancient ruins. As if my own castle back there. No, I wouldn't. I walked on. I almost knew the road. In a direction. Yes. Inevitably in a direction. A large lit house. Surrounded by a park.
They are partying in that house.
Ablaze with light and sound. There was a courtyard. Oh. Oh, this was the world. Oh, how brilliant it was. How merry. I had never heard human voices before. Yet it was familiar to me. Some of the faces seemed to hold expressions that brought up remote recollections. Oh, they smiled. They talked to each other. They laughed. Oh, world! The windows before me were two doors. I put my hands to each to enter and pushed opened into the joyous room.
Oh, shit.
And the people became silent. They all stared with a strange and familiar expression. I tried to speak to them. But it was hard to speak. No! I walked toward them, but they fled. Fled! Every face distorted. Screams! Hands covering their eyes. Stumbling away. Wait! Like mist, they faded before me. They seemed to melt into the walls, through doors, dragging each other. No, wait!
So sad.
Wait. They had all
been gathered before a wall, which now stood there. With gilded designs bordering an archway, but the arch was glass, reflecting the room. There was only one figure in it. Vague as I approached, then more and more clearly I could see it. It! Compound of all that is unclean, unwelcome, abnormal and detestable. The ghoulish shade of decay, antiquity, and dissolution. That ripping, putrid eidolon of some unwholesome revelation. The awful bearing of that which the merciful earth should always hide. It was not, or no longer, of this world. That in its eaten away bony outlines I saw a leering, abhorrent travesty on the human shape. Mine, no, no, no! The eyes as I approached held mine open. I couldn't turn away. But I would wipe out the sight. I'd reach out. I stretched out my fingers to the abomination. To touch a cold and unyielding surface of polished glass. But it would yield. It would yield. It would yield. At that last moment, I had recognized him. When I returned to the graveyard, the stone door was immovable. Now I ride with the mocking and friendly ghouls on the night wind and play by day in the catacomb. I know that light is not for me, save that of the moon. Yet in my new wildness and freedom, I welcome the bitterness of alienage. For I know always that I am an outsider. An outsider. Stranger in this century. For a time. A stranger among those who are still men.
That was so fucking good. Holy shit. I was gonna say that the second one was probably the best, right? Just because of the quality too, but the ending of this one was just so visceral and powerful. I felt genuinely heartbroken when the family ran away
from
him. That
was The Outsider by H.P. Lovecraft. The story was adapted for radio and performed by Eric Bauersfeld, with technical production by John Whiting. And now, good night.
Wow, that was just absolutely something else. That was crazy. Oh man, I really liked that last one. What did you guys think? Yeah, I don't know if he's a vampire or what. He's just sort of something horrible, you know, or I guess, you know, like, and I always, Lovecraft said that this was his, The Outsider was his most Edgar Allan Poe inspired work. And I think you can kind of get it that the themes are a little different than some of his other ones, which usually have less of a, almost sense of morality to them. But I think the reason that it's one of his most famous story, if not the most famous, is just because we've all felt that feeling of like being the outsider, the unwelcome, you know, even when you're in like a conversation and you say the wrong thing and then it's like everybody stops and looks at you. It's like we all know that feeling. And I think that it's just the most powerful version of that story, you know. So yeah, I was curious if it was the same voice actor from the second one and the third one, Rats in the Walls and not. Yeah, this was really cool. I was actually really surprised by this. I was worried that, you know, maybe I would enjoy it, but it wouldn't be that enjoyable for you guys. But if it's the type of thing you'd like to do, we can definitely do it like the third Wednesday, like Ryan was saying, or something like that, you know, where we keep doing some of these. Next time we can do the, I think it's called Quiet Please, and there's, I don't know, there's how many there are. Yeah, it would be a good night. Be fun to go through all of those. I've heard they're very good, so that would be fun, and then especially Sherlock Holmes ones. Yeah, a lot of wine. So anyways, guys, thank you so much for coming with me on this scum experiment. If you're just watching the video now, please like and subscribe to the channel, and yeah, this was awesome. Can't wait to do this next week. I can't remember if next week is the Christmas special. I think I've got one more week. So if I've got one more week, I think we're gonna watch The Wasp Woman by Roger Corman, the same director as Little Shop of Horrors. That's the plan, but you know me, I'm not that great with this stuff, where I'm kind of not always so impressive with that. So, anyways, guys, thank you so much for everybody who tipped, for everybody who's shared the video, for everybody who's liked and subscribed to the channel, for everybody who's been my friend through this incredible scum experiment. Not just tonight's scum experiment, but the whole thing. Like, the whole thing's an experiment. It was just a thing we started because of COVID, and now it's like my favorite night of the week. So I just want to say thank you guys very much. I love you all, and I'll see you next Wednesday, okay? Yeah, I think that's it. That's all I have to say. Good night.